Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be talking about what a batch reactor is. In particular, we'll talk about how they work, what they're commonly used for, and develop an equation for them. Batch reactors are considered one of the four ideal reactors that we will consider throughout this course. This means that we assume it's perfect in some certain way, i.e. for a batch reactor, we can assume constant volume and that the system is always well mixed. This ideal assumption is just to make calculations easier, as non-ideal reactors are not always so simple. They are often quite complicated to improve efficiency in some way. But the fundamentals of non-ideal reactors are often very similar to ideal reactors. However, they are just simplified to give students an understanding without getting too specific to any one non-ideal reactor. So, the way a batch reactor operates is by first adding in all our reactants, catalysts, or whatever is needed for our reaction. We then close off the reactor and let it react for a certain amount of time. So, for example, we could add all our components, and if our tank needed to be heated, we would let our tank get to, say, 50 degrees for 5 hours. After 5 hours, we could remove our reactive products. These type of reactors are very common at small scale for batch-sensitive material. These types of reactors are often slow, expensive, and pretty labor-intensive compared to some other methods, but it works very well for certain applications. It is very common to see these types of reactors in pharmaceutical, food industry, and many others. The heat transfer in batch reactors depends on the reaction occurring within the vessel. You could have a temperature changing system, so non-isothermal, a constant temperature system, isothermal, or an isolated adiabatic batch reactor, in which there is no heat transfer with the environment. The reason this depends on the reaction occurring within the reactor is because we do not want, say, an adiabatic system for a highly exothermic reaction, since we are likely going to need a cooling agent to keep the temperature of our system down. So, let's talk about the mathematical equations we are going to use to define batch reactors. Let's create a mole balance for some generic component inside of our batch reactor. We'll begin with the general mole balance that was developed last video. Now, all we need to do is eliminate terms that are not applicable to this batch reactor. Since we add all of our components before time zero, there is no flow into our reactor, therefore we can cross this out. Additionally, there is no flow out of our reactor either, and therefore both of these terms are equal to zero. Therefore, the change in moles of component A is going to directly rely on the reaction occurring within the batch reactor. This makes it much easier to control our quantity of fluid in our batch, and this is why the method is preferred for very sensitive products, like in the pharmaceutical industry, or in industries where there is a lot of cleaning to be done, such as the food industry. Thank you for checking out this video, and I hope it helped your understanding of what batch reactors are and what they're used for. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our Patreon page to support the channel. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below, and I will do my best to address your concerns.